Experiment 1 in CHEM 1310 is titled How Galvanized is Your Washer? In this experiment, we'll get a basic introduction to accuracy and precision. We'll explore some basic laboratory techniques in glassware that you'll use throughout the semester, and we'll analyze the zinc content of a washer by subjecting it to a chemical reaction and looking at mass changes. So you'll learn some fundamental techniques in this experiment that we'll use throughout the semester, and the experiment has some engineering applications as well. In this video and in other video introductions, I'll give you a basic introduction to the theory behind the experiment and an overview of the parts of the experiment and what you'll do in the laboratory. I wanted to start off by giving a basic introduction to the difference between accuracy and precision, two really important concepts in measurement theory. If you go on to take analytical chemistry, the difference between accuracy and precision will become eminently clear. Here we only need a very basic understanding, but appreciating the difference is important to interpreting chemical measurements. So what you see on the left are two different sets of measurements represented by four black X's. And the red dot here is what we call the true value of the experimental measurement. So this might be a two-dimensional measurement. You're seeing it on a screen. There might be two dimensions to it. And the true value is the red dot. The clusters of X's each have a mean that shows up somewhere in the middle. And the difference between that mean and the true value is accuracy. So accuracy reflects the distance of the mean of a set of measurements from the true value. So we might represent that, for example, with a line from the mean values in blue to the true value in red. And we can see that the second blue line here is much longer than the first. So the set of measurements over here is much less accurate than the measurements on the left. On the right, under precision, we don't see any red dot, and in fact, precision has nothing to do with the true value of the measurement. Precision is concerned with the spread within a set of measurements. So once again, you see a set of X's representing a set of measurements, five this time, and what we can see is that the measurements on the left are spaced apart to a significant degree. There is a very large spread of these measurements from one another. And in fact, if we plotted the mean on here, it would show up somewhere around this blue dot. We can see that each of the measurements individually is quite far from the mean, and that is the primary measure of precision. It's calculated in the form of standard deviation. The larger that standard deviation is, the more deviation of each measurement we see from the central mean value, and the lower the precision. The set of measurements on the right, on the other hand, are quite close to their mean, which would show up about here. There's a very small distance from each of the individual points to the central mean, and that indicates a high precision situation. So the set of measurements on the right are very high precision, while those on the left exhibit very low precision. And in the laboratory, we'll calculate this using standard deviation. In fact, the standard deviation of the low precision data is very large, while the standard deviation of the high precision data is very small. Once again, the lengths of the solid blue lines here give us a clue to the value of the standard deviation. When it comes to accuracy, we often talk about the percent error as a measure of accuracy. And the percent error is really just the distance between the measured value and the true value, normalized by the true value and multiplied by 100 to make it a percentage. So why is it normalized by the true value? Well, if the distance between the measurement and the true value is, say, 3 units, that doesn't tell us much, because if the true value is something like 5,000 units or 10,000 units, that difference between the measured and true value is, in the grand scheme of things, very small. So dividing by the true value helps us put the distance of the measurements from the true value into perspective. In part A of the experiment, we'll do two separate things. First of all, we'll measure and mass washers, and then in the second part of part A, we will degrade the zinc on the washers and mass them before and after to determine the mass of zinc present on the washer. So in part one, you are going to have in the laboratory 5 different valences labeled 1 through 5, and each of these is an independent instrument with its own set of independent measurements and independent calibration, but of course we would like to assume that they're all as accurate as they can possibly be. And you will also have 5 different washers, one of which will be what we'll call your master washer, and you'll make a little mark on that master washer to show that it is indeed your master washer. You'll measure all 5 on one of the balances, and then you'll measure the master washer on the five different balances. And the goal here is to see which of the sets of measurements, the five different washers all on one balance or the one washer on five different balances, has a greater spread or has lower precision. And I'll let you think about the factors that will go into that, but it has something to do with the specificity and the precision of manufacturing of the washers and the precision of the balances themselves and whether they exhibit a large spread of measurements or not. You'll see that in the laboratory firsthand. You'll also use digital calipers to measure the dimensions of a washer with the goal of measuring the volume. And there are three different quantities that are important to measure here. First of all, you want to measure the outside diameter of the washer, which is really just the diameter from end to end along the outside. This is the OD, or the outside diameter. That's obviously going to be important to the volume. But we also want to subtract out the empty space that shows up in the center of the washer. And to do that, we need a measure of the ID, or inside diameter. Finally, to calculate the volume, this is a cylinder, essentially, and we need the height of the cylinder, or the depth or thickness of the cylinder. I'll write it here as H for height. We'll need that measurement as well. Using these three measurements and assuming that the washer is a perfect cylinder, with the center cut out as a perfect circle, will allow us to calculate the volume of the washer. In a later part of the experiment, we'll actually measure the volume a different way by submerging the washers in water and looking at the displacement of the water after we've added a certain number of washers. These washers are galvanized, which means that they've been coated in a thin layer of zinc around the outside. So there's a teeny tiny layer of zinc on top of the entire washer surface that sits on the top of there and protects it from weathering and other effects of the environment. To determine the mass and thickness of this layer, we're going to subject the washer to treatment with hydrochloric acid. Two equivalents of hydrochloric acid react with the zinc coating to produce zinc chloride and hydrogen gas. And the way we'll tell that the reaction is complete is that you'll notice the bubbling of hydrogen gas coming from the reaction solution will eventually slow down or stop. The hydrochloric acid does not react with the metal that's underneath the zinc, and so the product that we'll be left with will be a washer that has no zinc left on it. So by massing the washer before and after the reaction, we can determine the mass of the zinc coating that was essentially a reactant for this chemical process. Using this mass and the density of zinc, which we can look up, we can determine the volume of zinc atoms. And assuming that that volume is spread uniformly over the washer surface, we can use the surface area, which we can again calculate from our measurements up here, to determine the thickness of that zinc layer. The density, or mass density, of a substance is equal to its mass divided by its volume. One clever way for measuring density involves essentially placing an apparatus for measuring volume on top of a balance. So if we place the volume measuring apparatus on top of the balance and then we essentially zero out the balance so that the apparatus doesn't contribute to our mass reading whatsoever, when we place the substance of interest inside this apparatus, we end up with a mass measurement that corresponds to the mass of that particular sample. And the volume measuring apparatus tells us the volume. So the mass is easy enough to measure. We need only mass the sample. But how do we measure the volume? Well, in this experiment, we're going to measure the volume of washers not only by the measurement method that we just discussed, but also by what's called the displacement method. And the displacement method is quite clever and works whenever the sample is not soluble in the liquid we're using for displacement. So we'll use just water in this experiment. And the idea is that if we start with a graduated cylinder containing some water at a volume V1, once we place the sample into this graduated cylinder, the level of the water is going to increase as a result of the volume taken up by the sample. So if I draw the washer here in black at the bottom of the graduated cylinder, due to its volume, the water, whose amount hasn't changed, is going to move upwards, and we're going to get a new volume reading, V2, and we can simply say that the volume of the washer that we added is equal to the difference between the final volume shown by the water, which is really the combined volume of the water and the sample, minus the initial volume V1. If we apply this method on top of a balance so that we're getting a mass at the same time, we can see that the overall density of the sample, in this case a washer, is just equal to the mass measured by the balance divided by the volume difference V2 minus V1.